is joined now. So I am requested to Abhishek. So can brief about Professor Inderdeep Singh, sir. So Abhishek.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Good morning to everyone. I would like to take the precious time to welcome our Professor Inderdeep Singh, sir, in this corona situation, taking his precious time and like spending it to us for giving a knowledge. And like Professors, Inderjit sir is currently a professor in Indian Institute of Technology, Roorkee, in the Department of Mechanical Engineering and Industrial Engineering. Sir has done his Bachelor of Technology from NIT Hamirpur in 1998, Master of Technology from IIT Delhi in 2000, and Doctor of Philosophy from IIT Delhi in 2004. And also has guided 13 students have completed their PhD degree under sir guidance. And also, sir has been a coordinator in e-learning center in IIT Roorkee and local coordinator in GIA and IIT Roorkee and coordinator in NPTEL IIT Roorkee and has been in many associate dean of a student welfare Indian Institute of Technology in Roorkee. And sir has a new number of research publication has published by the sir. We are very grateful to have Professor Inderjit Singh sir for here to share the your knowledge with us. We are very thankful for you, sir.
Thank you, Abhishek. I think we can start. Sabindr?
Yes, sir. Please, sir.
Okay. Good noon, all of you. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to deliver the very first session of this important faculty development program, especially on green technology and sustainability engineering. So before I start, I wish to highlight few important points related to the organization of such faculty development programs. Just I'll take maybe a minute or two, then I will jump over to the topic which I have been asked to deliver as the first session for this program. So normally, whenever we have such a program, there are three stakeholders which I identify as on my own personal front. That is, the main important stakeholders are the faculty members who join the program, because they give 5 days of their important time for conducting such events or being a part of such important events. And then they wish to enroll, then they register for the program with an aim that they will complete the program with some value addition, some new value addition or some new ideas, some new thoughts will cross their minds, because they are already faculty members, they are already teaching. Many of the participants of the program already have completed their PhDs. They may be further supervising PhDs, and they already have accomplished careers, but still they join the program to learn something or to get new ideas or to see that what is the latest being done in that particular topic on which the FDP is being created or is being organized. Now, the second stakeholders are the faculty members who are invited as the experts, who are also developing or creating new knowledge by doing some experiments, or they are developing some new processes, or they develop some new analytical tools, models, or they use some software tools for finding out some new solutions to the existing problems. So the stakeholders, and in terms of the faculty members who are delivering the sessions during the AICT sponsored program, also are important for the smooth conduct of such faculty development programs. And the third is the Government of India, which is spending money, which is paying the experts. And when these programs are conducted in the physical offline mode, the government sponsors the travel of the experts, also the travel of the participants, also the stay and boarding lodging of the participants. So an important stakeholder is the Government of India, which supports financially these programs. So all the three stakeholders, once the program has been completed, must have sense of achievement, some sense of accomplishment that yes, this money was spent, these were the speakers who came and delivered the lectures, these are the participants who attended the lectures, and finally the overall program has led to some improvement, maybe some delta improvement in the know-how in a particular field. So this topic, which has been selected very rightly, is green technology and sustainability engineering, is very, very relevant topic. Why? Because today we are seeing that there are so many issues related to the environment. And if we talk about the West, in Canada, we have some relatives there, in especially in the state of British Columbia, I visited 2 years back. There was a huge flooding. Huge flooding was there, and still there is a lot of water. A lake has been created there, where there were fields, there were farmers who were working there. But now, because of this climate change, there the area has been inundated with the flood waters, and it is becoming increasingly difficult for the government to reclaim that area which has now been flooded. So that is one important point. Now the temperatures, I was discussing with my co-brother there, that the temperatures which normally used to be 3 degrees, -3, -4 in the place where they stay in Abbotsford, that is going to -15 degrees, -14 degrees, which is slightly maybe on the lower side from the normal that they used to experience. Even in the states like Saskatchewan, the temperature is going to -50 degrees. So it is becoming difficult for people to live there who have been living for so many years. You know, why this is happening is because of the climate change that is taking place. So therefore, sustainable environment, sustainable products, sustainable processes, everything is important, and it must be discussed at various levels so that all of us take steps, whatever within our working domain, that can help the environment to be in the way in which we wish it to be. Means we want our children, our next generations to breathe in clean air, to drink the clean water. So it is our responsibility to see that how we can ensure that kind of sustainability. So this topic is very, very important, and we have been working in this for the last maybe 8 to 10 years, trying to develop some materials which we claim as the sustainable materials, because they are derived from the natural resources and then we convert them. Although the processes are energy intensive processes, but the end product that we are able to create is sustainable in nature, which means that the product can easily degrade into the environment without causing any harmful impact. And also an important ingredient of sustainability is the management of waste. So I will be talking about some strategies which are in use for management of the waste, which we are trying to create or which we are trying to develop in the due course of time. So there are a lot of important topics, as I could see. This is the very first session, so I will be discussing the basic aspects of the topic which has been selected by the organizers. But as I could see the schedule, there are other speakers from other NITs and IITs who will be coming and delivering the sessions during this 5-day faculty development program. And all topics are very, very interesting, and they seem to be focused on this important aspect of green technology and sustainability engineering. So please give me just one minute. I will like to share my presentation with this. Is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So before we start the discussion, you can see I have marked that logo of Stay Home, because it again, we are seeing a different variant and the cases are surging up like anything. And even in our campus, we have again seen, observed a large number of cases in the last 4 to 5 days' time. Many of the faculty members have tested positive. Also, the students have tested positive. Every evening, we have a health bulletin within the institute, which is shared by the chief medical officer of our hospital and the dean of students' welfare. So we are seeing a lot of challenges ahead in the next 3 to 4 weeks' time, because if it is a Omicron wave variant, then it is expected to rise sharply. The number of cases are going to peak very soon, and then equally sharply the cases are going to decline. That is what is expected. But only thing that is heartening is that even during this peak COVID period, we are able to organize this program, especially thanks to the communication technology that we are able to communicate and at least get to know some things from each other. So what I will request all of you is to stay home, try to avoid the large gatherings and wear the mask regularly. And that will also be some contribution towards fighting against this virus. And I feel that maybe within the next 3 to 4 months' time, we will be getting over this pandemic. That is a wishful thinking, and God willing, we will be able to do that. So the target of our session, that we will have maybe 1 hour, 15 minutes, 1 hour, 20 minutes, followed by the question and answer session, because Q&A is very, very important part of any FDP program, because the participants who listen to the session carefully will come up with some doubts, and those doubts may be addressed by the speaker, may not be addressed, some answer may not be available for those queries and doubts, but those will certainly act as the triggering points for further research, may give some ideas to the participants or to the expert to further explore in that domain, that some master's students or some PhD students can work on that important aspect which has been raised by some of the learners or some of the participants who attend the program. Many times I have seen few ideas came up during the discussion after the lecture, and then 2 or 3 MTech theses were completed based on that topic only, and we were able to publish also in very good journal based on those ideas. We explored, tried, failed, and finally when we succeeded, we were able to publish the results in very good journals. So therefore, maybe we will have a Q&A session after the lecture that I will be finishing. I'll try to finish. Please don't worry about the number of slides. I may skip some of the slides in between and try to finish it within the given time frame. So there are 3 things here in my topic. One I have already underlined, that is sustainable, and the other 2 are composite materials, and many of us know about the composite materials now, because when we started working, like as a student, I started working on composite materials in the year 1999. So almost maybe 21 or 22 years have passed when I first heard this topic of composite materials. And now in the last 20 years or last 2 decades, I review lot of research articles from India, from across the globe, where different aspects of composite materials have been analyzed, are being analyzed, and will be analyzed in future also. So this term is very well known to almost all engineers and scientists. But quickly, I will try to, for those who are new to this topic, maybe they may be working in some other area, or they may have their research interests in some other areas also. So very quickly, I will try to align their thinking in the direction of composite materials, and then we will move on to the sustainable composite materials and what is the importance of these materials. Thereafter, I will try to address 2 or 3 processes that we have developed here at IIT Roorkee, which we are using for making the composite samples. And finally, we will try to address that how these materials are sustainable, because what are the various waste management strategies for these materials, and what are the results that we have achieved while focusing on their recyclability. So basically, what is the target for any sustainable manufacturing. So we need to select the raw materials judiciously. We need to use the processes to convert those raw materials into final products judiciously. And finally, whatever final outcome of the product, maybe the product is used for some specific purpose, but after some period or after the end of life of the product, what has to be done with that product? That must also be environment friendly. So it is a complete cycle. It is not only just choosing the right materials for your product. You may choose the right materials for your product, but the process that you are using may be quite damaging for the environment. So it completely loses the focus on sustainability. Means the advantage that we try to leverage by choosing the right materials is lost by choosing the wrong process. So it is a complete cycle, right from the choice of materials to the final end of life management of the product. That has to be ensured in a very, very energy efficient manner, in a very, very environmental friendly manner, and in summary, we can see in a sustainable manner. So we will try to see the concept of sustainability, especially in terms of engineering, because the target here is green technology. So the word technology is coming in here, and sustainability engineering. So the term engineering is coming into picture. So we will try to address both from the technology and the engineering point of view. So let us start now the topic, three terms: sustainable, composite, and materials. So composite materials, well known to all of you. So we will start with the important term, that is sustainability. Now, what is sustainability? Why sustainability is important? Because we see that there are limited resources, limited space, limited know-how, limited time, and so on. So always engineers and scientists have to work with constraints. There are so many constraints in terms of resources, time, even money. All things are limited in nature. So therefore, within those limited resources, we have to work. And if there are infinite resources, for example, I have infinite number of people who are at my command, whom I can direct. If I have infinite money, if I have an infinite space available with me, then I don't feel that there is any need to study engineering or to learn management or to study science. So always we have to work with limited resources. So therefore, we have to ensure that we should not eat into all the resources. We should leave some resources for our next generations also. So we need to be sustainable, which means that we need to look at the usage of our resources in a way that the resources are available in the environment, in the nature, for longer duration of time. So we need to be sustainable on all fronts. So we need to be sustainable on economic fronts. We need to be sustainable on social front. We need to be sustainable. Already I have increased the font to emphasize, because our target will be to ensure the environmental sustainability. I will be focusing more on environmental sustainability rather than focusing on the economic or the social sustainability. So how we can work around engineering and technology so that we are able to be sustainable in terms of environment friendliness. Now, as per the UN definition, as you see on the screen, a sustainable development is the development that meets the need of the present. So whatever we require, we should be able to meet that without compromising the ability of the future generations to meet their own needs. So which means that if today we are getting clean water, today we are having clean air to breathe, then we should ensure that we do the development in a way, sustainable development is the focus, so that our next generations also get the clean water and air to breathe and drink. So since I will be talking more on technology and engineering, and manufacturing is one of the important aspects. So what is our current model of manufacturing? So if we see, our current model of manufacturing is take, make, and waste. So these three terms are very, very important in any manufacturing. Whenever we talk about any production system or any manufacturing unit, what is being done? For example, I am sitting on a chair, the laptop is on a table. So the table has been manufactured. The chair has also been manufactured. The laptop has also been manufactured. So what has been the focus area here? The focus area is that some materials have been taken. These may be coming from environment, may be coming from, sorry, someone wants to add something. Okay, then you can just mute your mics. It will make the things more comfortable. I think one of the participants' mic is on. So you can just check. The organizers may please check if somehow by mistake the mic is on.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Muted the mic, sir.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So basically, if we see the current manufacturing is on the model take, make and waste. So we select the materials without being conscious about the environment. And all of us know, I will not repeat those things. The government is also focusing on many materials that we want to get rid of these materials as soon as possible. So the manufacturers these days are not having a very, very focused approach on the choice of materials that they want to use for creating the various products. And then once the choice of materials has been done, the product is manufactured using the manufacturing processes. There are different manufacturing processes. And there also the focus is not on how the environment is getting impacted by the choice of those processes. And finally, once the product has been made, it has been used by the consumer or the user, what happens to that product? Whether that product is environment friendly after the end of life, or we are disposing it off. Many times we see that we do the landfilling. So we will dig a pit and we will dig out the soil and put all that waste material there and then just fill that pit. So whether that is the right way of doing the waste management, so that is also need to be investigated. So the take, make and waste model of manufacturing, which currently we are following, is not going to help us in achieving our targets of sustainable development. So therefore, we need to look at all the three aspects from the broad viewpoint of sustainability, that the materials that we choose for making products, the processes that we employ for converting these materials into tangible products, and the end of life strategies for the products which have already lived their life, which are already broken, which are already written off, how to manage that waste. If we are able to focus on all these aspects as engineers and scientists and architects, we will be able to find some solutions which will lead to a better living place for all of, not only for all of us, but for our future generations also. Now, taking means already I have explained, we take the resources from nature. Manufacturing, we are always focused on energy intensive. We want to quickly produce the product. Many times we also lead to overconsumption of resources. A lot of wastage during the manufacturing leads to overconsumption of resources. And sometimes the waste that is produced during the manufacturing, I will show you how this waste looks like, especially the process that we have used, that is of injection molding. So how it the waste is created and how that waste can be recycled. Finally, we have to focus on how the product will be used and how it will be disposed, or how the product can be reused, we should say. Many times we see that there are always, I normally give this example to the students in the class, that has anybody any idea that how the medals for the Tokyo Olympics were made? Anyone? Any participant? You can unmute and speak.
No, sir.
No idea?
No, sir.
So you can just read about that, though, how the medals, so they were made from the metals extracted from the electronic waste. So whatever, because huge amount of electronic waste is produced not only in Japan but all across the world. So the it was reused, the metals were extracted and then they were used for making the medals which were given in during the medal ceremony. So gold, silver, bronze, they were made from the metals which are already used in different products. So that is what I read in one of the news items in the newspaper. So how to reuse our material, reuse our products in a positive manner, which can help us to reduce the burden for new materials and new new materials from the already stretched nature. So we are always extracting one or the other thing from the nature. So whatever we extract, if we are able to minimize that by reusing whatever is already circulating in our environment, that will make the things easier. So this is normally a product life cycle. Deliberately, I have given the color green here because we want to make the things as environment friendly as possible. So the materials that we choose, the methods that we use, the distribution or the logistics, there is a term which is very, very famous these days for the last 15, 20 years, that is supply chain management or the logistics. So we work out the logistics in a way that we have to spend minimum amount of money on transporting the goods from one place to another place, or whatever methods we choose for distribution of the products must be environment friendly with minimum impact on the environment. Then the product, when it is being used by the customers, it should have minimum impact, as well as the disposal. That is the most important part. The burning of the waste or the incineration that we normally call it, and the landfilling are not the environment friendly ways of disposing of the waste. So that also has to be taken into account, that how to manage our waste in a circular economy. And if you see, this is giving a green circle, which means that when we are disposing of the waste, it should be converted into materials which are again being used for making the products. So that cycle has to be ensured. So if we are able to ensure this green cycle, which will make the things more environment friendly, we will be able to achieve our target of sustainability. Now, there is a concept from this book, the source is also given, which is called as the design for environment. So this is an important topic. I will just try to show 3 or 4 slides only, but these are 2 chapters which are given in this book, Product Design and Development, 5th edition by Carl Ulrich and Steven Eppinger. So what is design for environment? So design for environment, basically, if you see, it focuses on minimizing or eliminating the environmental impacts of a product over its life cycle. Now, we have to see that what are the various DFE guidelines for selection of materials, for manufacturing, for waste management, for logistics, for use. So for each and every life cycle, which we have seen in the previous slide, materials, production, distribution, use, and disposal, for each stage of the life cycle, there are standard DFE guidelines. We may not be able to cover these guidelines today, but at least you can have a look in the book that what are the various guidelines for choice of materials, for the methods, for the use or consumption, or for the disposal. So therefore, it is mentioned here over its life cycle. So the previous slide gives the life cycle. So it is not only that during the design stage only we have to follow these guidelines. These are spread all across the life cycle of the product. So it is a method to minimize or eliminate the environmental impacts of a product over its life cycle. So once we are able to effectively use these guidelines, so this will help us to maintain or improve the product's quality and cost while reducing the environmental impact. So we will be able to develop the product in a cost-effective manner. The quality will not be compromised, but what we will achieve by following these guidelines is that we will be able to reduce the environmental impact of the product. So as we have seen, the traditional manufacturers, I have shown one slide, normally follow the take, make and waste model. So we need to change that psychology or that thought process of the manufacturers or the traditional manufacturers, so that they are able to choose or take the natural materials only for making different products, use the processes which are environment friendly, and finally the product must have some tag that how it has to be disposed of into the environment. One of the examples can be the disposable flower pots. So if we use a disposable flower pot, so we can just grow a small sapling in that flower pot and put that flower pot along with the sapling into the soil, and maybe after 3 months the flower pot automatically decomposes and becomes a part of the soil only. So there are those kind of products, because what happens to the product after it has established or it has satisfied the function for which it was manufactured, it also has to be thought of by the manufacturer. So the manufacturer has to change the thought process from take, make and waste model to a new philosophy of sustainability, a new philosophy of circular economy, a new philosophy of reverse logistics, where they need to take some of their products back into the chain and try to reuse them as much as possible. So DFE expands the traditional manufacturers' focus on production and distribution of their products to a closed loop life cycle, which is also sometimes termed as the circular economy. So these are two life cycles that are shown here from the same book. There is an industrial or product life cycle. So I will try to see if I can annotate and make things slightly more clear. So if we see that this is the same thing, we have the materials, we have product here, distribution, which we have already seen, we use the products, and finally the products are recovered. So these are the two catch points where we can easily focus. One is the materials, another is the recovery. So in recovery, there are also further options. We can either reuse some of the parts, as I have told the example of the metals. We can remanufacture some of the parts. We can post-consumer recycling can be done. We will take one example of recycling also in the today's, or we can just dispose them off into the environment. So even at the recovery stage also, there are different options which are available. So different products will offer us different options. So we have to see that as a product designer or as an engineer, that what can be the post-life option for a particular product. Now those options will become maybe evident if we are intelligent enough to work out at this stage itself, at the choice of materials stage itself. Because if at that stage we do not take the judicious decision of selecting the natural materials, then we will face a lot of difficulties at the recovery stage. So it is a complete cycle that we need to focus on, because if we are doing something wrong anywhere in any of the stages, then our recovery from that product will become a lot difficult. So in order to make our life easier, when the product has lived its life after the use and we want to recover some parts from the product, we have to take judicious decisions at every stage of the industrial product life cycle. Now, once we dispose them off into the environment, they will become a deposit, and then natural decay will take place, and they will again get converted into the resources, and these resources can then be extracted. So our target is to somehow club these two cycles together in order to achieve our overall target of sustainability. So if these blue arrows can be somehow integrated with this natural bio life cycle, our life becomes easier. Or that is, you can say, the ideal scenario, that we make use of the natural resources and then we put them back into the environment and they are again converted into the resources which are again extracted. So it becomes a completely natural life cycle, completely natural bio life cycle. So that is the target, but that may not be possible because in our life we are using many products which go through the conversion process in a way that it is difficult to achieve 100% recycling or 100% reuse of those products. So there are challenges, but this is the ideal scenario. So what we can do to start with, what can be the easier process? The easier process can be this, that we try to focus more on the non-renewable resources that we are using. So we try to focus on non-renewable resources, which we see here, non-renewable resources. So we try to avoid the use of non-renewable resources and focus more on the renewable resources. So at the material or choice of materials that we are doing, so from the material selection point of view, let us take a pledge that we will focus only on the renewable resources or renewable materials. And once we are disposing them off into the environment, if we see here, we should only dispose of organic material into the environment and avoid the toxins and the inorganic, which are difficult to degrade. So whatever can easily be degraded, only that material must be disposed of into the environment, which will certainly then undergo the natural decay process and the resource, it will again get converted into the resources. So these are some of the basic ideas that can be taken into account when we are designing new products. When even I am happy to share with all of you that we have started a Department of Design here at IIT Roorkee in the last academic year. So we have two master's programs. One of them is Master's of Design. Other one is Master's in Innovation Management. And in Master's of Design, we have put a core course on design for sustainability. So one core course is there, which every Master's in Design student has to study, because that is the importance of this topic. That whatever products we design, we should have an element of environmental awareness also among our designers, so that they keep in mind that what materials they are choosing, how they are going to impact the environment, what is going to be done with the product once it has lived its life. So all those things are important from the new product development point of view. So therefore, at two interventions we can very easily do. One is the choice of materials, and another one is the disposal into the environment. So after the use, so once the product has been used, what should be done, but how we are disposing it, that is also can be a very good intervention. So if at these two levels we are able to focus our attention, we will be able to do a word of good for our environment. So now what we are doing at IIT Roorkee in this direction, that I will try to focus on. So what are the conditions of sustainability? We can see here, eliminate. This is the summary of what we have already covered in the last two, three slides. Eliminate the use of non-renewable resources, that is focus on the renewable resources. Eliminate the disposal of toxic or synthetic waste into the environment. Eliminate the creation of toxic waste that are not part of the natural biocycle. So in a way, we have to focus more on the natural biocycle in order to achieve the target of sustainability. Now, what we are doing here is related to some kind of research efforts that are being put. So we are now trying to focus more on materials and methods which can be sustainable in nature. So more importantly, today I will be talking more on the materials aspect, because we are also now doing some work in the direction of energy efficient manufacturing. And at IIT Roorkee, there are a group of just a minute. So there are a group of faculty members who are also working on the manufacturing processes which are energy efficient, which are intelligent, which are environment friendly, minimizing the impact on the environment, minimizing the fumes like near dry EDM process. So there are efforts being done on the manufacturing processes also in order to make them environment friendly. But our is there a question? Okay, no. So we are focusing on advanced materials which are environment friendly. So this is an important diagram taken from NPTEL source. And if we see here, today we are going to talk about the composite materials. So there are other families of materials also which are available, and there is a wide variety of processes which are used. There are wide variety of processes. So if we see these processes, we will, this is the grading. A and C. A means widely used, B means not frequently used, C means not used. So for composites, we have lot of C's, which means that many traditional processes which are very good for metals. If we see that for metals, we have so many A grading, A and almost all A's here also. So there are many processes which are widely used for metals, but the same processes cannot be used for composites. So which means that we need to work on the manufacturing aspects of composite materials to make them even more realistic, and in order to ensure their commercialization as wide as possible. So we this justifies the efforts being put by work researchers or the students. All across the country, I am seeing now that there are a lot of research papers being published, a lot of PhDs being produced in the area of composite materials, because this is giving us some hint. This may be a old diagram from a book, but still we see that there are a lot of research gaps available in the field of composite materials, where a lot of efforts are still required, especially in terms of ensuring their cost effective, high quality manufacturing. Similarly, a lot of efforts are also being noted where new and new alloys in terms of metals are being produced, as well as the manufacturing processes for metals are also getting revolutionized. For example, there are 3D metal printing equipment or machines which are available, which can make the products as complex as possible, because now the 3D printing is taking place not only of the polymers but also of the metals. So there are trends in the field of metals also, in the field of composites also. In fact, all basic category of materials we are seeing lot of advancements, but this diagram shows that there is lot of efforts which are possible in the field of composite materials. So within composites also, there are different families of composite materials. There are polymer matrix composites, there are metal matrix composites, there are ceramic matrix composites. So we will broadly focus on the polymer based composites, because the plastics is a big challenge, and even it is many people call it as a man-made disaster. So we see here that only 9% of the plastic waste is normally recycled, and majority of it, almost 80%, is accumulated in landfills or it is dumped into the natural environment. So which is not a healthy practice, and it damages the environment or has a detrimental impact on the environment, and many times on the marine life also. It enters into the food chain also through the marine life. So there are a lot of challenges associated with plastics. Therefore, a lot of efforts are required to put in the direction of managing the plastic waste also the associated composite plastic waste, which means the fiber reinforced plastics or the polymer matrix composite materials also have to be managed in a way that they are recycled or reused or remanufactured, or they are disposed of into the environment in a way that they are having a minimal impact on the environment. So burning also causes air pollution. So if we see 80% is filled in landfill, 12% is incinerated, which means burnt. So that burning also has to be avoided. So we can see that if the current trends continue, the oceans could contain more plastic than the fish by the year 2050. This is from the UN study on environment. This is another case study of a river side in China. A lot of plastic waste. So it is a kind of a man-made disaster, and we will be focusing on some of the World Environment Day themes. So if we see regarding 2018, the theme for World Environment Day given by UN World Environment Day theme was if you can't refuse it, if you can't reuse it, refuse it. So beat the plastic pollution. So this is UN environment you see here. Similarly, in 2019, it was beat the air pollution. And if you see in 2020, it was time for nature. So we see that a lot of efforts are being put worldwide in order to sensitize the global research community to put efforts to focus more on the environment. So if we see how we can do that, or what we are doing, so what we are trying to do, reduce the use of plastics by incorporating the natural fibers or additives, which means that if the product is made of 100 grams, if we are able to put 20 grams or 15 grams of some natural material there without affecting the functions of the product or without affecting the performance of that material, then very easily we can say that we have been able to reduce the burden on the natural resources by 15 to 20%. Or the other approach can be that whatever products are already being used, try to reuse them by recycling. So both these aspects we are trying to address, and we are trying to develop the natural fiber based polymer composite materials, and this is a effort towards the sustainable development. So composites, all of you know, and deliberately I have colored this polymer matrix composites in green color, because our focus is making them environment friendly, as green as possible, as environment friendly as possible. So the composites, as all of you know, are a combination of two or three different materials which are physically distinct, which are chemically different, and we combine them together to achieve the properties which are not possible by one individual constituent. So therefore, depending upon the requirements of the properties of a product, we try to choose our materials so that we are able to make the products, make the material which is going to meet the targets of the design or meet the specific design requirements. So this is just from, we can see from the markets that there are different application areas of composite materials. And we see here on the right hand side, if you see, materials are increasing in the last few years. And if we see in 2000, somewhere around 2012 or 13, the 50% materials that are being used in the aircraft industry are the composite materials only. Why? Because they afford us a very important property, that is high strength to weight ratio. So they are light in weight, and even at light weight, they provide us very high strength. So that high strength to weight ratio gives them an advantage over the other traditional materials, and therefore the lightweight alloys and lightweight composite materials are being used in the aircraft industry. This is the composition. We can see 50% are composites, and others are the other materials like steel, titanium, aluminium, and others. Now, this is something which is matrix and reinforcement, synthetic fibers and synthetic matrices, and these are some of the application of synthetic fiber reinforced composite materials. But what is our target is that we have to use the fibers which are sustainable, which are available in the environment in abundance, and we need not manufacture them, especially for you being used in the composite materials. The energy intensive processes that are used to make the carbon and the glass fibers, if somehow we can change them into more environment friendly processes or environment friendly materials, then that will make our life very easy. So we see now we are in the peak winters here in the northern part of the country, but as soon as the summers will set in, this problem of forest fires will start to damage the environment. So therefore, there are number of natural fibers which are available. One of them is the pine needles, which are available in the hills of Uttarakhand, Himachal, and even in the other Himalayan states. So therefore, these needles can easily be used as fibers for reinforcing the polymers, reducing the burden on polymers, and reducing the burden on the petroleum derived resources. So this is we can see that different types of natural fibers can easily be used. These are animal fibers, which are derived from wool, which are in the form of wool, silk, or they can be fibers like coming from the leaf, like sisal or palm fiber or banana fiber. So we have used quite a lot of these fibers as reinforcement in the polymers, and even if they are not able to reinforce the polymer, at least they are able to reduce use on polymers. If with same strength, same functionality, if we can use these materials for various non-structural applications, it will reduce the usage of the polymers. So that is the target. So we may not be able to completely replace the polymers by the fibers, because both the constituents, the fibers and the polymers, have to play their own role in making a composite material. I am not going into the intricacies of the advantages of composites and how composites are made or what are the mechanics of composite materials. I am trying to emphasize that whatever composites are available in the market today, there is a possibility of converting some of those composite materials into the more environment friendly composite materials by using the natural fibers. Even currently we are working on basalt fiber based composite materials also. So this slide is just to justify that there are a lot of different types of natural fibers which can be used for making the composite materials. Now if we are only able to replace the fibers, for example, the synthetic fibers which are made by energy intensive processes like the glass or the carbon fiber, by the natural fiber, our final end product or our composite may not become fully green or fully environment friendly. So we have to focus on both constituents. The matrix or the polymer that we are using must also be environment friendly. So the polymers also must be derived from natural resources. There are number of polymers these days which are available, which are coming from the natural roots, and the fibers that we choose also, if they come from the natural fibers or they are coming from nature, then if we combine the two natural materials together, we will be able to make a fully green material which will be environment friendly and which will suit our purpose of sustainability or sustainable engineering. So we are trying to develop these composite materials using the biosourced polymers and the natural fibers and trying to combine them together to get the biocomposites. So what is the target about developing these sustainable composite materials? Now we are trying to target on three important aspects. One of them is that these must be coming from, as we have seen in the beginning regarding design for environment, that what are the conditions for sustainability, that we should focus more on the natural resources. So whatever materials we use, they must come from the renewable resources. So first, important characteristic of sustainable composites is that the raw materials that we use for making these composites must come from the renewable resources. The second characteristic is that these, once the product has lived its life, it must be able to be recycled. So recyclability is the second aspect. And third is, if we are not able to recycle it because of the constraints, then it should be able to be degraded either using some bioenzymes or maybe naturally putting them into the under the soil. They should degrade automatically into the natural elements. So if these three characteristics are satisfied, that the materials that are being used for making the products are coming from renewable resources, the product is recyclable after the end of life, and if not recyclable, it is biodegradable, then we can say that it falls in the broad category of sustainable composite materials. And also, there can be a material which is possible, which is coming from the natural resources, which is even recyclable, it is also biodegradable, but then as engineers we have to see that it must be able to satisfy the environmental acceptability criteria also, and it must be commercially viable. For example, if we are able to make a carry bag which is coming made from the natural ingredients or natural constituents, and the process that is used for making that carry bag is also environment friendly, and finally you can dispose it off into the environment without having any adverse impact on the environment, but the cost is supposed 200 rupees for that carry bag. I don't feel that many of us would like to use that product. So therefore, the commercial viability of that material also has to be established. So we have to see, because most of the time when we propose to replace material A with material B, the first question is, what will be the cost implications? Then we come on to the comparison in terms of functionality, comparison in terms of mechanical properties, comparison in terms of toxicity, comparison in terms of the environment friendliness. But first of all, we look at the commercial angle only, that what we need to pay extra to use this material. So therefore, the commercial viability is even more important than the justifying the other comparisons that I have already listed. But yes, there are efforts. People are working all across the country, all across the globe in developing these type of materials. So the natural fiber based composites, as we see here, are the, we can have partially green composites, where one of the constituents, as we have seen, that we combine 2, 3, 4 constituents together to make a composite material. So if some of the constituents are natural, others are not natural or synthetic, then we say we have been able to make a partially green composite material. But if all constituents that are being used for making the composite material are coming from natural resources, in that case we say that we have been able to create a natural fiber based fully green composite material. So this is another important slide that we see here, classification of the composites based on various constituents that we use. So we have here natural fibers and biodegradable polymers, which are biopolymers or natural, so naturally sourced polymers. We get fully biodegradable composites, or fully degradable. Bio means we need to add some additional source for degradation, but here we can say fully degradable composites. But on the contrary, if we use synthetic fibers and non-biodegradable polymers like polypropylene or epoxy or polyester, then we get the non-biodegradable composites. And if we see now, these synthetic fiber based composites are slowly becoming an old practice, and the research trend now is towards the development of fully biodegradable composite materials. So these are some of the applications of the natural fiber based materials, and if we see, they give us a completely wooden look. Now, what can be the research trends here? The concept, I think I have been able to build during the last maybe 1 hour that what is the concept of materials, what is the concept of design for environment, what are the key elements or conditions for ensuring sustainability, what are the composite materials, what are the different types, and what is the importance of the natural fiber based composite materials. Now, what can be the, many of you may have got interested, many of you may already be working in this area. So what can be the research efforts in this direction? So that we will try to see. We can explore different types of natural fibers, as there is a huge cache or huge availability of natural fibers in India. I don't have that slide today, but India is one of the largest manufacturers of different types of natural fibers. So we have a wide variety of natural fibers available. So first thing can be that we try to choose the different fibers, different biopolymers, and try to combine them together. So these are some of the samples. A bigger picture I will show maybe in the subsequent slides. So first thing is the development. Now, how to develop the materials, it is also a challenge, because you are combining two or three. Just a minute, give me one. Okay, sorry, there was a break. PhD student has called. So the development is very, very, you can say, challenging, because we are trying to combine two different materials together. But there are technologies, there are techniques, there are processes which are available, there are articles which have already been published. I will show you one or two processes that we have developed here in-house at IIT Roorkee for making these samples. So it is easy to make these composite materials nowadays. So what we can do is we can do some optimization here, try to develop a new process which is more effective, which is more efficient, which is more cost effective, which gives us better quality products. So some efforts can be put in development of composite materials, that is choice of processes or development of techniques for making the composite materials. Next can be, we can evaluate their performance under different types of service conditions. So we can make different products with composite materials and try to see that what are the various service conditions in which they will be expected to deliver, or in which they will be expected to function. So we can simulate those conditions in an accelerated way and see that how these materials will behave under different service conditions. Then at the end of life, what can be done with these materials? That is also an area of research where we can work on the waste management practices or strategies for these materials. Even we can work on the degradation of these materials under different types of natural environments and see that how the materials degrade over a period of time. So right from the selection of the raw materials to fabrication in terms of products, and then analyzing the performance of products under different environmental conditions, to the end of service life, waste management strategies to degradation, there are a lot of efforts which can be put. If I choose maybe only development, that I will only try to develop the composite materials, that also is also a good effort. I can make different types of samples, test them for different properties, maybe the mechanical properties, the thermal properties, the machinability properties, the tribological properties. So development and characterization can be one of the good topics in developing these sustainable materials. Also, as I have told, there are research opportunities at different stages of the product life cycle for these materials. And incidentally, we are focusing on all. keeping in view the interest of the students who join our team here at IIT Roorkee, we discuss, deliberate, and try to finalize that at which stage or at which aspect we are on which aspect we are trying to focus. Recently, one PhD has been completed on the degradation studies on natural fiber based composite materials, and currently students are working on various aspects of composite materials. So this is just to give you one idea of the first strategy of making the composite materials or focusing on the manufacturing aspects of composite materials. This is just one framework of research which can be worked out, because there can be some of the faculty members who may feel interested to work in this area. So the choice of natural fiber, there we have written banana fiber and pineapple fiber, then polymer matrix, then mixing these, then using different processes. The pink boxes, they focus on the various processes that we have used for making the composite materials. Then different types of analysis can be done depending upon the requirement. Flexural tensile impact properties can be found out, and then other analysis can be done like the XRD or the fiber distribution and orientation. This is the processing of the fibers that we see. This is a pineapple fiber, fiber extraction. Normally we don't go to this level. We directly buy the pineapple fiber from the various manufacturers which are available here. And then we do these steps manually here: fiber chopping, soaking, drying, sieving, getting the exact shape, exact, sorry, size of the fibers. And then we dry in the oven to avoid any kind of moisture. Then we seal them in the airtight packets to avoid the moisture absorption during storage. And then we use them for different processes. So these are some of the images of the natural fibers, and these are the images of the polymers. So we use a biopolymer. We have already published this. If anybody is interested, you can write to me over email. I would be happy to share the article with you, so you can read the article in detail. This is just one case study I am trying to build, that how the research can be taken forward and how we can try to come up with the final material which can be used for various applications. I will show you some of the applications also. So I will just quickly, so this is the mold that we use, because we have to do the testing under standard conditions. So ASTM standards have to be followed. So as per the standards, we have got this mold designed, and this, in this mold, we have three cavities. In a single shot, we are able to get three samples. In cavity one, we will get the tensile sample. Cavity two, we will get the flexural. Cavity three can be used for the impact analysis or DMA tests. So these are the processes, these are the processes that we have used. That is the direct injection molding. If we see that we are using the fibers and pellets, these are the chopped fibers as we have seen in the previous slides. These are the polymer pellets. We combine them together in the injection molding hopper here, and then through the screw feeding arrangement, and there are heaters here. All of you know the basic principle of injection molding. We are able to make these samples. So in single shot, we are able to get different types of samples which can be used later for the characterization. The other process that we are using is the combination of extrusion and injection molding process. If we see here, this is extrusion first step. So this is the extrusion process. So here we extrude the polymer composite wire. This is the wire that comes out, and here it is cut into the pellets. This is the exploded view of the pellet. So these are the compounded fibers and polymers together after the first stage. So first stage is extrusion. So these fibers and pellets are compounded here in the hopper, and then they are converted into the composite pellets, and these pellets are now directly used here. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
I got some message that something is not right. Okay. So these composite pellets are used here in injection molding. So the second stage is injection molding. First stage is extrusion. And then we use these pellets here and make the samples here. So this is another process that we have tried to see, and we have been able to make the composites successfully and compare the, these are the samples made. Three tensile samples are shown here. So this is these are two processes that we have used. So the these materials can also be used for the fight against COVID-19. If we see here, this is one case study which was published in Composites World, that Italian research agency has developed the smart shelters using the biocomposites. If we see here, and what were the raw materials used here, we can see here. So these were made by eco composite sandwich panels by using the bio-based polyurethane and recycled PET foam and natural fibers. So the raw materials which were used for making these shelters, this design is shown here, was made by biocomposites material. This is just one case study, mobile healthcare unit, which was made by the biocomposite materials. Then there are other opportunities also. This is one face shield that 2 years back we developed here in our tinkering lab under Professor Akshay Divedi. So this was made. So later on we discussed that this frame can easily be made with the natural fiber based composite materials, because it is a non load bearing material and it can easily be fabricated using the injection molding using the bio based materials only. This is another generic hands free. Normally during the COVID we are hesitant to touch the buttons of the lift if we are staying in a multi-story apartments. Even for opening the door handles at public places, we sometimes try to avoid touching the hands. So these type of hands-free devices can easily be made using the bio-based composite materials, as we have seen. Biodegradable cutlery, because we don't want to use the cutlery again and again, so we can make the biodegradable cutlery using the recently one of the companies, I think Lavasa, which is in I think Italy, they have made a edible cup which is made from some waste coming out of the wheat. So that is edible. So they, after drinking the coffee, you can eat that cup. So that is another important step towards ensuring sustainability, because otherwise these disposable cups or disposable cutlery, which is made up of the polymers or different plastics, is a huge source of plastic waste. So if an edible cup has been invented, so it is going to solve this problem also in a big way. So after eating the coffee, after drinking the coffee, you can eat that cup. These are the ward separator walls. Certainly we would like to have them as light as possible. Their only purpose is to ensure the privacy to the patient who's there inside. So these lightweight materials like composites can be used, and here this is not going to have many load bearing applications. So here we can use the natural fiber based composite materials for making this wall. This is one of the students' project which was completed, where this jute fiber was used for making this chair. So this is a metallic frame which can be recycled, and the jute fiber, which is also reducing the burden on the environment. This is a boy student testing it after sitting. So the waste management is very, very, I will try to now wind up, because I have another session also around after lunch. So the waste management is a very big challenge for composites, and here I am talking about the synthetic, because we don't see very, very large scale applications of natural fiber based materials, but we see a huge application potential or applications of carbon fiber and glass fiber based composites. So we can see here that CFRP waste, the amount of waste is mentioned, that by 2050 how much carbon fiber composite waste is expected to be there. So we need to develop some strategies for managing this kind of waste. We cannot put it directly into the environment or into the oceans, because that is not advisable from the sustainability principles point of view. So therefore, there are a lot of waste management strategies for composites being worked out, as I have already highlighted some of these strategies as we see are the landfilling and incineration, which is not a very healthy practice. Landfilling is also having detrimental impact on our soil quality, water quality, underwater quality. Burning is having an effect on the environment, especially in air pollution. The energy generated by burning also is not that much, that so that we can harness that energy. Recycling, yes, is very important. If we are able to recycle the composite waste, that is going to serve our purpose. So the waste materials can be reprocessed into products, materials or substances, whether for original or alternate purposes, and hence can act as better waste management process. So this is a better waste management process as compared to the other two which are being used these days, that is landfilling and incineration. So reuse and recycling are the catchwords that are going to lead us into the future, and we will see that how this can be done in just one or two slides. So this is one important slide. This is from latest articles only. We see here 2020 this article was published. So if we see the recovered carbon fiber applications, so initially if we focus on the high-end applications, we see this is a virgin carbon fiber based composite material. It is a structural component which is being used. So the strength of fibers is high, so fiber reinforcement potential on industry. So the aircraft industry, aeronautics and aircraft will always focus on virgin fibers, high strength fibers, because they have to achieve the high strength to weight ratio. On the other hand, if we use small fibers, recycled fibers, we can focus on non-structural components where we are not expecting very, very heavy loads acting on the product. So from high-end application, structural application, to low-end non-structural application, we can recycle the carbon fibers in multiple ways. And from unidirectional, all fibers in one direction type of composite laminate, we can use them in the powdered filler form. The carbon fibers can be converted into a powdered filler, and it can be used as a filler material in a thermoplastic polymer matrix, and that will give us a product which will be having application which will not be a structural application. It will be a filtering device can be made which will be having no load coming on that product. So therefore, from a structural component and virgin fibers, we can go to recycled fibers and non-structural component. So the recovered fibers from waste are used in applications that require less stringent mechanical performance and lower cost than the pristine or the virgin or the new carbon fiber. So this can be one waste management strategy for carbon fibers, that is recycling of the carbon fibers, the recovery of the carbon fibers from the composite waste, so that they can be reused for some other applications, not in the same application for which they were being used earlier. So that is one thing where it can be recycled and reused. So we are also degradation. Okay, I will skip. I have highlighted this. I will come to this is the recycling of the polymer composites. So this is some efforts that we have put here at IIT Roorkee. So we can see here different samples are shown, different many such thousands of such samples I think in the last few years we have made. So these are some of the different types of composites that are made. So as I told you, in single shot we are able to get three samples. So this is sample one, which is the tensile sample, this is flexural sample, and this is the impact testing sample. So in single shot we get three samples, but you see that we get this sprue in each shot, in each injection molding shot we get this sprue. So this sprue that we get, this is around amounting to around 10% of the waste. This is the process waste, so we cannot avoid this. In every cycle we will get this material which is also solidified inside the or at the sprue of the injection molding mold. So this is amounting to almost 10% of the process waste. This is the waste. So what we are trying to do now is that we palletize it, this waste, into again smaller pellets and reuse it for making again the recycled composite specimen. So this is our first samples that we make with the new polymer and new fiber. But then we take out, cut this waste we collect, and then we use, palletize it again, you make it the into the pellet form and use it again for recycling. And you can see the change in color between the fresh samples and the recycled samples. And then we again get this waste here. If you see again, that screw is coming here. So this screw again, we will cut and again collect it, recycle it again, and again make the sample. So different levels of recycling we have done, up to five for some kind, combination of fibers and polymers. We have gone up to 7 recycling steps. For some others, we have gone for 5 recycling steps. So different recycling steps we have seen. And what is the beauty of this investigation? We have also published this. I will be happy to share the articles published on this. And the advantage here is that we can get the properties. If we see that for pure polymer, this is the pure polymer that we see here, which is mentioned here, neat polymer is giving us a tensile strength of 54 MPa. So this is 54 MPa. But if we add fibers into the polymer, if we use the fresh fiber, this is the strength around 62 megapascal. But even after recycling, different stages of recycling, if we recycle it 5 times, the strength that we get is still higher than the strength that we get only with the polymer. So if we add fibers, especially these short natural fibers, into the bio-based PLA polymer, we will be able to improve the mechanical performance of the material. At the same time, even after recycling it 4 or 5 different times, still the strength remains higher. So which means that if we use this product for one application, as we have seen in the previous slide for carbon fiber based composite materials, so initially for a structural application, for aircraft application, new fiber is used, but it can be recovered multiple times using different processes, and the recovered fibers can be used for some other applications. Similarly here, this is showing the recycling of the complete product multiple times after palletizing, and it can be again used for some or the other product applications, which means that we need not focus on new products, new materials for always making the natural products. We can recycle the available materials into the new types of products. So I think I will stop here. We can have some time for question answers also. One topic, degradation, I have skipped, but no problem, some other day. So that's all from my side. If there are few questions, you can ask. I hope I am able to clear few some of the doubts.
Thank you so much.
May I ask a question, sir?
Yeah, please.
Sir, respected sir, we have seen a lot of application of this composite material in our routine life. But my question, is there any scope to use this composite in agriculture?
Yes, for different in agriculture, the one of the studies which was being conducted by GB Pant College of Technology in Pantnagar in Uttarakhand only, they were trying to make some agricultural implants which are not much load bearing, replacing wood. So in place of wood, which is used for making the different products for medical, for agriculture, they were trying to use the composite materials for agricultural applications. So if you wish, I can send some of the pictures which they have shared with us. Actually, we have a design innovation center here at IIT Roorkee, and GB Pant Agricultural University is one of the spokes who are closely working with us. So their target was to develop some non-structural products which are used for agricultural applications using the composite material. So yes, they have applications in agricultural sector also.
Yeah, thank you, sir. And I have a second question, please, if you don't mind, sir.
Yeah, please. Please go.
Can we get this presentation after end of this session?
Yeah, some almost all the results we have published. So whatever there are two or three slides that I may not be able to share, but rest all I will share with the organizers.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. I had a doubt. Sir, you spoke about the sustainable composites that are biodegradable mostly. Sir, what makes you think that there is a consensus between like biodegradable materials are susceptible to contamination by certain microorganisms? So is there any study that has been done to prove that these biodegradable materials, when they are intact with a structure or a superstructure, that is not been contaminated with the microbes and hence reducing its longevity? I would like to know your opinion on this, sir.
Okay. So, yeah, that is an important question which has been asked earlier also during the presentation. So, if we see that the basic premise of developing a composite material is that the fibers are encapsulated in the polymer matrix. So the fibers may have the tendency to be attacked by moisture or by microorganisms or by microbes, but normally when we use them in some superstructure or some structural application, the fibers are not supposed to be exposed to any kind of microbial attack or the microorganism attack. So they will be completely covered by the polymer. So that we have to ensure that the polymer that we use, which is acting as a matrix material, is not affected by the microbes or microorganisms that you are pointing out. So that is a point that has to be taken care of. But we have made whatever composite materials we have made, I have even exposed them. They are lying in my office for the last maybe 8 to 10 years time. Nothing has happened to them. They are as good in finish as we made them. They are lying just in open in the office, and some of the samples are in the Almira, and some of the samples are being exposed. I deliberately kept them outside of my window where they are exposed to rain, they are exposed to sunlight, they are exposed to harsh weather conditions. Now, right now, the minimum temperature we are experiencing is 5 to 6 degrees. And in the last week of December, we experienced 3 degrees, 2 degrees also minimum temperature. So those samples are exposed for last 8 to 10 years under those conditions, and nothing has happened to those samples. So this is my personal, investigation, where we have not tested them under any specific climatic chamber, but just in our day-to-day life, and seen that these materials are able to sustain their shape, their dimensions, and are not being attacked by any external microorganisms, because the polymers normally are not attacked by the organism. So, but yes, if we use a specific biopolymer which has a tendency to be attacked by a specific microorganism or a specific set of organisms, then in that case we need to treat that polymer or compound that polymer before being used for making a sustainable composite material.
Yes, sir.
I hope I have been able to answer.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. But sir, basically you are speaking that they are resistant to this contamination and degradation. So basically these structures are prone to physical fractures or physical destabilizations. Okay, that is not in our hand. So once it get destroyed, and again it will become a solid waste management issue actually. Then how you are making that, like you are telling that it is not it is biodegradable, but you're telling that it is not being attacked by microorganisms. These both two statements are, in my view, it is contradictory statements, as there will be a solid management issue coming on. See, all this, when there is a physical rupture or a physical fracture, they become a solid management issue. So I would like to know opinion on this, sir.
No, Mr. Jagadish, I think you have missed an important point where I mentioned that we are not focusing on structural applications. So whatever products we have tried to develop are non-structural products which are not going to be used in the load bearing applications. So non-structural products, normally when we use them, maybe they will not fracture too often, because we have made certain photo frames using these materials, we have made pen stands using these materials, and they are there for the last 5 to 10 years time. So the target applications that we are proposing are not the structural, that we are going to change the beam of a building using these natural fiber based composite materials. We say that various applications, like maybe the mementos that we give to the dignitaries, which are currently suppose made of wood, they can be made by these materials, or the table furniture, the table top office upholstery, like the pen stands or maybe the paperweights, which do not carry too much load, those can be made by these materials, because they have huge volumes which are being used. And if we are able to replace at least two products on our table for each one of us, it will have a huge impact on the our dependence on the plastic parts that currently being used for making these products. So that is the target area. The target area is not replacing the structural components by these materials.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Any other question? So, I think there is no question from the participant. Okay, so thank you so much, sir, for your kind information. So you are, I'm Abhishek. Hello.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Abhishek. Sir, can conclude.
Thanks. Thanks, sir, for your precious time and during this pandemic, and like also to make time for share your valuable knowledge with us in your busy schedule. Thanks for making time for us, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Can we see some questions in the chat box? I don't see any question there.
Yes, sir. There is no question in chat box.
No, sir. I think like all the doubts have been cleared, sir. Like it was very valuable knowledge session, sir.
Thank you. Dr. Yogita has written, please, sir, please share the articles you're talking about working on these. Okay, so I will share one or two articles also with you, but you share them to those who are interested. So normally, as per our practice, we should not share the articles in public domain. So Dr. Yogita, if you can drop an email to me, I will share the articles with you. All right. Okay, thank you. Thank you all of
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thanks.